and his ministry. This is not a night for great rejoicing. It is a night intended to be dark and somber and reflective and contemplative. It is a time for us to break bread together, to share a common cup, to be serious and intentional about our need for God's forgiveness. It is also time to reclaim a tradition which is ours, and that is the receiving of ashes upon our forehead, not as a sign of our piety, but as a reminder that all of us have come from dust and that at one point on our life's journey, we shall return also to dust. The mark of the Christ is upon us all, and in this service, this night, we receive the sign, the symbol, the promise, and the forgiveness once again. You will note in the bulletin that there is no opportunity to stand tonight. It is to emphasize the humility that is required of all of us to meet the standards of our Savior and our Creator. We together, then, are called to worship on this night. Let us sound the call of a solemn assembly. Let us pray and fast and gather God's people together.
Let us gather and bless all in this congregation of faith, young and old, male and female, joyful and sorrow-filled.
This is the beginning of true repentance, a time to turn to God with our hearts opened wide.
We turn to God for understanding and forgiveness of things done, which should have been done, of things gone undone, which should have been done. We open our hearts to the brokenness before us and in us.
We seek God's amazing forgiveness to create a clean heart within us.
On this Ash Wednesday evening, this is the way that we worship God.
The first hymn that we sing tonight is Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. It is a very thoughtful text and poem from a person who is known as America's beloved Quaker poet. Indeed, he's regarded as one of our nation's ablest and most distinguished poets. John Greenleaf Whittier wrote the text for this hymn in 1872. He did so to express his Quaker conviction that the way to God was through simplicity, sincerity, and humility. To Whittier, the degree of a human person's belief in God was always reflected in the way that person made use of the life God had given him in his love relationship with others. So let us sing together. In the midst of this solemn assembly, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind.
Father of mankind, forgive.
introduce me with prayer. Gentle and loving God, we thank you for your Lenten walk through Galilee and through the midst of our lives. We thank you for your healing grace and your teaching challenge. We thank you for the miracle that our little gifts are turned into many loaves. We thank you for the parables that call us, the supper of Passover and Passion that makes us whole, the cross and tomb and heaven that calls us. Gentle and loving God, we thank you that what is written in the Gospels and in our hearts is the story of Jesus the Christ, the Savior from Nazareth, born in Bethlehem, to lead us to God's purposes for life. We pray all of this with affection and devotion. And we ask that your Spirit, dear God, might now descend upon our hearts. Yet it is very important for us to look to this gracious and powerful writing on this Ash Wednesday evening. The book of Joel is the second of the 12 short prophetic books, which together make up the concluding section of the Old Testament of our faith. Nothing is known about this author apart from his name. The writing suggests Jerusalem as their place of origin, and the date has been variously given as post-exile or pre-exile, but we believe it to be about 400 years before the birth of Jesus. The occasion of the prophetic word here appears to have been an unusually severe plague of locusts, which suggested to the author the imminence of the day of the Lord. There are two main topics in what Joel writes: the prophecy of the outpouring of the Spirit and the Pentecostal experience of the early church and the joy they found in the Lord's presence. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, it is near. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes. Their like has never been from of old, nor will be again after them in ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Indeed, blow the trumpet in Zion and sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the aged. Gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room, and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord. Do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the people, where is their God? On this Ash Wednesday night, in this solemn assembly, we are called to trust the promises of our faith and to engage in the act of confession. Let us pray together. Merciful and loving God, deliver us, we pray, from knowledge that elevates us and makes us insensitive to the needs of others. We confess that sometimes our freedom has offended another's conscience, and our carelessness has caused others to stumble and fall. Our actions have not been consistent with what we say we believe. Forgive us, O God, and restore us to a meaningful relationship with you and with other seekers after your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Believe and trust that all who come and are heartily sorry will indeed be forgiven. In the sharing of our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings, we symbolize the giving of ourselves. Let our ushers for this night please come forward. And let us pray together our prayer of dedication.
We give thanks, dear Lord, for all that we have received, the gifts of love and time, money and abilities. Into these place and into this place, we return a portion of these gifts. Bless those who receive them, just as we are blessed in the act of sharing them. Amen.
And let us sing together, Spirit of the Living God. The oppressed achieve new dignity, and all will live in peace. Gracious God, we've allowed ourselves to be distracted and busy with many deceptive things we see as desirable. We crave success and material bits and pieces. We've hurt one another. We, each of us, all of us, have participated in devastating your Earth's resources. We have waged wars with your other children. And now, gracious God, on this Ash Wednesday, beginning the journey of Lent, we come to ask you to forgive us, to lead us, guide us. Help us to remember that we are nothing without you. And that even as we receive the ashes this evening, that we one day will return to that same ash. Make us a people ready and willing to witness with our lives and words the truth that Jesus came to give those who were broken and to redeem the world. And in these next moments of silence, may we, in the language of our hearts, lift those persons, those needs to you for special prayer and your very special presence. Gracious God, help us as one people to unite in the prayer of Jesus when he said, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The second lesson this evening comes from the Gospel according to Matthew. Matthew, you recall, is the Gospel writer, the teller of the good news, who looks carefully to the prophetic wisdom of the Old Testament as he tells the story of Jesus. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them. For then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give an offering, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give an offering, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your offering may be done in secret, and your Father, who sees in secret, will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. Whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, For neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. This is the word of God for the people of God. Precious Lord.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord.
On this Ash Wednesday evening, may you touch our hearts, minds, and spirits. May you take the imperfect words of my mouth, the meditations of each of our hearts, and direct them to a perfect understanding of your love and your care for us. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Grace and peace be to each and to all from God our Creator and the Lord Jesus Christ. My dear friends, it's a bit of an embarrassment to make the following confession that I will make. I remember as a young man seeing some of my older relatives constantly have food stains on the front of their shirt, and particularly on their ties. My commitment was to never let that happen to me. I now make at least one trip a week to the laundry to remove some of the troublesome spots, which I thought would never be mine. Now, there are not only spots upon my tie, there are spots upon my shirts, the front of my suit coats, and even my overcoats, which suggests to you that I'm sometimes snacking at a time when I should not be snacking at all. My wife has taught me to save some money, so I'm not to the dry cleaner all the time. She's given me a method, and that is where I have something that can be laundered at home, I need to prep it, I need to blot it, and then I need to clean it. Now, I would like to suggest to you that we, all of us, are like my shirts and ties and suit coats and sometimes overcoats, much as we have promised in the past to avoid the stains upon who we are. The reality is, there are spots and blemishes upon and within all of us. And we need to discover, all of us together, and as individuals, how to prep the spots, how to blot them, so as not to extend the stain, and then how to receive the gift of cleansing. I would like to read for you one other brief passage of Scripture. In addition to the passage from Joel and the passage from Matthew, hear this from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. There's that magic word. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my brokenness is ever before me. Against you alone have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, you desire truth in me. Purge me. Let me hear my own inner joy and gladness. Hide your face from my brokenness and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. This is a prayer of confession. It's a prayer of confession not from an anonymous character in another time. It is a prayer of confession from the great King David, who came to the moment in his own life where he needed to acknowledge the blots and the stains upon his person. And he's reaching out to God for forgiveness and the creation of a new heart and a right spirit within. While we were visiting our son Christopher in California, we worked a lot on redoing some rooms for Christopher and Elaine. Normally we'd work most of the morning, take a quick break for lunch, and then work early in the afternoon. Come 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we would stop, take a break, and I would flip the dials of the channel selector on the television. I can't even tell you what show it was, but it was an afternoon talk show in Southern California. And you know, if it's in Southern California, it has to be strange to a certain extent. Well, this is what I caught. I caught several young people standing on a stage with an audience out in front and a moderator who was very smart. Or at least he thought so. And they were discussing the lifestyles of people living in Southern California. And someone started to accuse one of the panelists, a young woman, who apparently had just talked about something she had done wrong. He said to her, "You are a sinner. Do you know that?" The response from the audience was laughter and applause. But it didn't stop the young woman at all. She moved it into high gear. And this is what she said: "Doesn't anybody really sin anymore? I mean, here we are, living among all these terrible things. Mass murder, a shadow of the Holocaust, all these assassinations and terrorist bombings, beheadings, and everybody's doing whatever he or she wants to. Does what I do really matter?" And nobody on the panel or in the audience or the moderator said a thing. It was a big question, and they weren't sure of the answer they needed to give. Does it matter what we do anymore in the kind of world we live in? I would like to suggest to you, for Christians, this is one of the chief questions of our time. A question that Ash Wednesday addresses in no uncertain times and terms. It does matter the way we live our lives. It does matter that we purge the things which pull us down and seek that creation of a kinder, deeper heart and a right spirit in each of our lives. The season of Lent gives us the opportunity to seek that right spirit and clean heart. Now, I'd like you all to believe that I've never made a mistake in my life. I would like you to believe that from the time I was born, I have led an absolutely spotless white life. But I know better than that, and so do you. years ago still comes back to me. In moments of my own isolation, I see vividly acts of unkindness in my past existence. I see moments when I was less than kind to my wife. I see moments when I was less than compassionate to that person on the corner begging for a buck. Well, everyone knows that's just a scam. In this season of Lent, if we open ourselves fully, we have the chance to expunge and to purge a great deal of that past journey. We have the opportunity to face it straight on, to receive the gift of God's forgiveness. And even in moments of remembrance, to lose some of the pain. My wife says I'm incorrigible about my shirts, my ties, and my jackets. She's probably right. But I trust I'm not incorrigible and have the courage of King David. Say, gracious God, forgive me. Create in me a new heart and the right spirit. I guess it really is about learning to pray and want and to finally be able to cleanse. Jesus knew with each of his disciples in a day and an age long ago that they were not spotless wives, which is encouraging for us. But he also knew that they had to open themselves to each other in new and loving ways to find the kingdom that he envisioned for us all. And so in a final minute with his disciples, he took bread and blessed them and broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body broken for you, for the forgiveness of your sin. Take and eat as often as you do this. Do it in remembrance of me. And then he took the cup and once again giving thanks. He gave it to them, saying, this is the new covenant in my body shed for the remission of your sin. Take and drink. And as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Communion is open to all who desire to taste and see how good the Lord is. We invite you all to come to the table this night. We'll come down the center aisle. We'll take the bread, dip it in the cup. And as you ingest that symbol, that promise of God's presence and love for you, will you step by the cup and the bread and receive the mark of the cross upon your life and your future. The words that will be spoken from the palm branches that provide the ash for us this night. We come from the dust. We return to it. And on the journey we pray. created us with a new heart and a new and light spirit within us. Lord, would you come forward? I invite you from the east, the west, the north, and south. Come, taste, and see how good the Lord is. Gracious and loving God, we are so deeply thankful for all that you have given us and all that you promise yet to be ours. May you bless us in the midst of this mighty little engine of a congregation. People who are honest about their failures and hopeful about their successes. Help us not to be consumed by remembrance of brokenness in our past. Help us to be focused on the promise that is ours. We are so thankful, so blessed, and so grateful. We now say amen and alleluia.
Yeah.